Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Rebellious CEO, 12 Leaders Who Did It Right, by Ralph Nader, narrated by Joe Barrett. Introduction. This book is an easy listen for business students, current and future business leaders, and for a discouraged citizenry. During 6 decades of confronting CEOs in many different industries and lines of commerce, I have had, from time to time, one-on-one meetings with the heads of corporations. Some of these meetings were desirable, others were necessary. In some of these encounters, I've found a few CEOs to be wonders of values and performance. These meetings turned out to be impressive, educational, and even encouraging concerning the state of what other CEOs could emulate. This book, the result of these encounters, selects 12 CEOs who exceeded my expectations. These are people whom I got to know and grew to admire. All but 3 have passed on. Their work generated forces that have made our economy better than it would have been. Whether their practices and accompanying wisdom continue to reverberate and resonate outside of their immediate circles is hard to say. Their lives and work provide examples that can benefit the present and future if more people, more students, are able to learn about these leaders and examine how they overcame their challenges to deal with the human beings whose lives impacted or were impacted by them. I met many other CEOs at various events, conferences, social gatherings, and even depositions. I found most of them to be prisoners on temporary leave from their top-down authoritarian corporations. In more informal settings, they spoke as less fettered human beings. Some cases in point. Paul Austin, a fellow Harvard Law alumnus and CEO of Coca-Cola, advised on a walk to lunch that, contrary to popular lore, large, powerful corporations were, if put under certain pressures, fragile and vulnerable. I countered by asking him why he used his obvious talents in the service of a company that sold a non-nutritious, sugary drink all over the world based on a secret formula locked somewhere in a safe in Atlanta, Georgia. He replied, "I don't see anything wrong with selling a refreshing drink." Here's another instance of that informality. The CEO of Armco Steel once told me he took his board of directors on a sensitivity trip deep into a coal mine that the company owned. "They didn't want to stay there very long," he said. When they emerged above, he heard them mutter that they would never again say coal miners were overpaid. When we had these exchanges, neither of these gentlemen was accompanied by advisors, assistants, or flacks. Each spoke candidly. Unfortunately, such relative openness was not often on display when they were operating in their normal realm, whether in an executive suite or shareholders' meeting. One reason for my choice of the people profiled here is that each displayed forthright candor, competence, and a recognition of the complexities of society that shape the bottom line. I want to say at the outset that if I didn't want to keep this book relatively short, other CEOs who were productively engaging in the community could have been added, whether, depending on the scope of their interventions, that be community writ large or small. I might have chosen Peter B. Lewis, CEO of Progressive Insurance Company, who performed in exemplary ways as a philanthropist. He built the tiny company started by his father into the 3rd largest auto insurance company in America. He was the largest contributor to the ACLU, funded progressive think tanks, and was one of a few billionaires, along with George Soros, to openly oppose wars of empire and press for peaceful diplomacy as a solution to global conflicts. He was my classmate at Princeton, where I remembered him as almost shy. Nothing like the iconoclastic, bold, flamboyant head of his insurance company, or the daring promoter of architectural and artistic projects that he became. It took just one lunch with Peter for me to convince him to equip Progressive's large fleet of company cars with airbags. Only Travelers Insurance Company did this earlier, and dramatically, it was because of an airbag that saved an employee's life in a collision with a truck. Peter was a believer in insurance companies fostering loss prevention, or safer products and conditions. At my urging, Peter led Progressive to become the first auto insurance company to give their customers comparison rates so they could price Progressive policies in relation to those of their top competitors, such as Allstate and State Farm. This was done even though in some localities, Progressive might not come in first. When I informed him about my plan to establish the first tort museum in the world, the American Museum of Tort Law, in Winsted, Connecticut, he blurted a pithy description of what the place was all about when he exclaimed, "Tort law is quality control for the insurance industry." However, he declined to become one of its numerous founders. Peter took the giving pledge, promising to give away at least half of his fortune to good causes during his lifetime. Unfortunately for the many civic charities he was contributing to and for those on the drawing board, Peter died from a heart attack on November 23, 2013, at age 80. A many-splendored free spirit with a keen appreciation for marijuana, which he first used as a pain reliever after part of his leg was amputated in 1998, he left many who met him with off-the-wall stories about his thoughts on grass and other matters. He once told me that when Princeton investigated him before nominating him to its board of trustees, he gave Princeton more than $200 million over the years, their report called him a functional pothead. Peter, like many of the best CEOs, understood that working to mitigate societal problems through his advocacy, philanthropy, and style of corporate leadership would benefit the world and his company. In Joel McCower's optimistic book from the 1990s, Beyond the Bottom Line, Putting Social Responsibility to Work for Your Business and the World, he offers numerous examples of socially sensitive companies: StrideRight, Levi Strauss, South Shore Bank, Ben & Jerry's, Stonefield Farms, Just Desserts Bakery, and others, led by progressive doers and thinkers. Some of these firms had elaborate, enlightened mission statements. All believed that a wider arc for their company made their firm, workers, and suppliers more productive and happier, leading to more satisfied customers and a more profitable bottom line. McCower said such a corporate culture, one that took a wider perspective on civic culture and the environment, was reaping the benefits of benevolence. However, if one looks with less rose-tinted glasses than the ones McCower wore, it's noticeable that some of his snapshots were of large divisions of companies, like Freddie Mac or Reebok International, divisions that were doing something commendable, while the rest of the company operated in conventional, profit-seeking ways, with all the liabilities that accompany such a narrow focus. Others that he justly praises went out of business or merged with larger corporations and lost much of their identity. Enthusiastic forecasts of a growing trend of corporate civic consciousness put forward by progressive business groups, such as Social Venture Network or Business for Social Responsibility, did not materialize as hoped. Instead, we sometimes saw a contrary trend over the last few years. Indeed, companies emerging from Silicon Valley, or those that are part of the gig economy, often took irresponsible steps backward, while the standbys, those companies that have always stood against a strong civic culture, such as banks and other giant financial intermediaries, and the venerable, ever more entrenched military-industrial complex, persist. Among new corporate threats are the triad of new technologies, described in Bill Joy's landmark Wired magazine article from 2000, Why the Future Doesn't Need Us. He warned of the looming risks from artificial intelligence, biotechnology, and nanotechnology, which are proceeding full speed ahead, with no legal or ethical frameworks to restrain them. Rarely has such a portentous forecast been more on target and less heeded once its immediate shock value wore off, swept aside by recklessness or the headlong rush for more of the latest sensation and profits. And that meant more corporate science and technology driven by ever narrower monetized minds, regardless of consequences. In contradistinction to the leaders at the head of this new wave of reaction, the chief executives portrayed in this book provide fertile and fascinating materials for study. They made ethical choices to promote civic culture and the natural environment. Self-chosen behaviors not required by law nor industry practice or custom. They challenged stereotypes slapped on their line of commerce, stereotypes which saw them as made up solely of companies that put the bottom line above all. They chose higher, ethical behavior, declining to avail themselves of the routine excuses about duty to shareholders, competitive riskiness, government regulation, or other pretexts most executives employ for explaining why they are not making beneficial changes. They were trailblazers whose own conduct and that of their companies shaped distinctive pathways toward excellence. The executives profiled here stood against the gray crowd. They were all unique individuals, so meeting them could understandably lead one to conclude that they were all completely different in personality and style. Even so, they shared an astonishingly uniform set of characteristics. The only one of these executives also depicted in Makaura's upbeat treatment was Anita Roddick, founder of the body shop. That was his choice, even though 9 of the 12 of my selected CEOs were in full operation at that time. Curiously, though confident and upbeat, they did not, as Makaura did, extrapolate their achievements as part of an upward, unstoppable trend. They shared a tough-minded pessimism. They were too realistic in their appraisal of the corporate resistance to change, no matter how much their forays into social responsiveness and internal company humanity were proven to benefit sales and profits. Other innovators in the mid-90s, the time Makaura was writing his book, waxed euphorically about the future in the same way Makaura did. As an example, Ben Cohen, the upbeat ice cream magnate, said that if business was smart, it had better jump on the progressive bandwagon because altruism was good for business and staying competitive. From a glance at today's business climate, you can see how few that bandwagon picked up. Paul Fireman, CEO of Reebok International, was equally euphoric, saying about the same time, "I believe we're on the verge of what might be a genuine shift in our nation's priorities, an official end to the me and greed decade. We now know that the conditions of our business cannot be separated from the conditions of the society in which we operate." Another mistaken prediction. For most companies, the only difference in their control of society's institutions is that now companies have changed to reflect greater diversity in their hiring and promotions. Otherwise, their baleful influence continues in force, diversity notwithstanding. The 12's similarities were striking. But on second glance, you can see these character traits were functional prerequisites for getting things done their way. Another trait was that they marched to their own drums. They couldn't care less what people thought of them. Restless Bob Townsend, who ran Avis through a turnaround, among other executive tasks, made his writing, speaking, and consulting career out of jolting contrarian thinking. Gino Paolucci, who started many companies, mostly in the food and packaging business, discovered that to win the sale from his position as an underdog, he had to do brazen things as an upstart. They all did the improbable. Ray Anderson had to reinvent his large carpet tile company, Interface, from the bottom up to make it environmentally responsive. John Bogle reinvented his industry by pioneering the low-fee Vanguard Group as a mutual company, not a stock company. It is the message of Paul Hawken, the environmentalist and entrepreneur, who goes around the world preaching the gospel of reinvention and showing corporations how they must somersault their operations to achieve sustainability before time runs out for the planet. Another commonality among these leaders? They insisted on treating their workers and customers well. All CEOs mouth that they are committed to their workers and customers, but it seldom goes beyond lip service. These CEOs meant it and delivered. Herb Kelleher, CEO of Southwest Airlines, fostered a family-caring culture in a firm that employs 66,000 people. His personal touch included reaching out to its workers to help them get through turmoil and tragedy. Employees I have talked to, I was a frequent flyer on this airline, tell me the caring standard of management toward workers is almost too good to be true. Kelleher put the well-being of workers first, even before that of customers, and he explained why. As for addressing their customers in a way that goes beyond expectations, speak to Yvonne Chouinard's Patagonia customers, and you'll see what I mean. Idealistic as all these CEOs are, and no matter how many different good causes they and their companies pursued, they shared another trait. All these CEOs insisted that nothing would be possible if they didn't pay attention to profits. Thus, they were heedful of the details of their businesses. Anita Roddick spared no effort in designing the body shop stores for an authentic, warm atmosphere while posting bold signs urging actions for justice. She was an environmentally aware person who made clear to her environmentally conscious customers that she was detail-minded in relation to ecological concerns, which ran from her choice of suppliers in tropical forests to the reuse of bottles for the store's sales. While restaurateur Andy Shalal, as he continued his political activism, personally reviewed menus to make sure they were hitting his customers' taste buds. He created the artwork on his restaurant walls to ensure a positive atmosphere and made sure there was no censorship at his attached bookstores and public event rooms, so the bookstore and event patrons got a full perspective. Every Saturday, Bernard Rappaport of American Income Life Insurance Company telephoned his general agents one after the other for brief chats about the state of business. However, none of them avoided speaking out against injustices for fear it would offend customers, cause political retaliation, or hurt the bottom line. They refused to censor their political views. They named the political candidates they supported without worrying that they might lose sales. Saul Price, the Jewish founder of Price Club, condemned the functioning of grand juries and funded Palestinian job training and other charitable activities to the consternation of some of his Jewish business colleagues. Rappaport also championed labor unions as the CEO of a life insurance company. This stance was unheard of at the time in this staid, reactionary, non-unionized industry. Gordon Sherman of Midas Muffler offended Chicago's business upper crust with his open support of tough advocates who were working to rein in their chronic abuses. I rarely heard any of them whine about government overregulation. For one thing, they went beyond the regulations, doing more for environmental and civic betterment than was required by law, especially in the case of Patagonia and Interface. For another, they realized that corporations deserved to be regulated or broken up, given what most corporations were not doing about corruption and pollution, among other abuses. This is why Gino Paolucci took those who wronged him to court, suing in all directions as one way to protest dishonest peers. Most of them, too, were founders. They had control and exerted it to get things done, to get the best out of people, to give their company meaning and be concerned with issues beyond maximizing the company's profits and personal wealth. Kelleher was for years by far the lowest compensated executive among big airlines, even though he was running the country's most profitable airline. He was paid less than $1 million a year. But he retired a wealthy man because Southwest's stock greatly appreciated during his tenure. The company's wealth was spread around. Everyone at Southwest was awarded shares, a payback for their commitment and helpfulness. John Bogle of Vanguard made such priorities specific in his remarkable book, Enough, where he chastised fellow executives who made amassing money their number one goal. As founders, the 12 could imprint on their firms their own special character, personality, and vision, developing an expanding structure that they intimately shaped. Were they to have inherited a bureaucratic company, it would have been far more difficult to produce such accomplishments. Most of the CEOs in this book are white men. Unfortunately, gender and racial equality in the corporate suites increases at a glacial pace. In 2021, 86% of Fortune 500 CEOs were white men. Only 1% of Fortune 500 CEOs were African Americans. In January 2023, the percentage of women CEOs at Fortune 500 companies hit 10%. Most of these 12 had stable families and showed care and compassion in their daily lives. They were generous with time and money toward others whom they encountered, whether in their family circles, their businesses, or their outside philanthropy. They set examples for their employees. They were hands-on people who were good at foreseeing and forestalling situations that might destabilize or harm their workforce. Kelleher never laid off a single worker in the boom-and-bust airline industry. This is not to say they never made wrong decisions or took the wrong track. Some made mistakes that shortened their tenures as controlling CEOs. Anita and Gordon Roddick were persuaded that going public would provide more resources to expand and help them do more of their remarkable groundbreaking philanthropy and democratic institution building. It didn't work out. They lost control of their company. This cut short their exponential contributions to world betterment. This was particularly tragic because Anita, among all those profiled here, had the most all-encompassing grasp of how to turn the world around and shift power from the few to the many. She expounded her views in her four books, which are marvels of readable, visual, personal, no-holds-barred challenges to the present exploitations and environmental degradation, while clear-sightedly offering ways to democratize the world and fulfill human possibilities. In another tragic case, Gordon Sherman challenged his angry, conservative father for control of Midas Muffler, which Gordon took from the tiny firm of his father's in Chicago to a company with hundreds of franchises around the world. He lost the shareholder struggle and was pushed out just when his momentum and the philanthropic Midas Foundation were getting underway in a peerless, bold fashion. None of the CEOs profiled were interested in turning their companies into conglomerates, nor in themselves becoming preachers. As to conglomeration, for one thing, they knew how difficult it would be to manage such corporate sprawl. It would dilute the high standards of their original business enterprises. When asked to franchise his restaurants, Andy Shalal shrugged his shoulders and said he doubts anyone could replicate his personal hybrid model. Only modestly were they interested in spreading their business gospel. They preferred to speak through their actions, though Ray Anderson, an exception, made hundreds of speeches in which he hammered home in technological detail the dire necessity of making sustainability the number one priority for business. He persuaded upper management and Walmart to reduce their excessive packaging and therefore reduce their costs. But aside from Anderson, the group of CEOs pretty much stuck to their tasks. They did not fear competition because their way of competing was so far ahead of their industry peers. Let's turn the page on that destructive way of living and doing business conducted by today's corporate chiefs and look to the example outlined by these exemplars. I'm going to divide them into two classes. Despite the commonalities I pointed out, I still see a division, one which will structure this book. Some are visionaries, such as Anita Roddick with her environmental consciousness, or Yvon Chouinard with his love for the wild, who had a crystal-clear vision of the way the world should be moving. They poured all their energy into their visions. Others are mavericks. These are CEOs who were just all-around humanists. They didn't move in tune to a burning vision, but simply acted in solidarity with the people and progressively to solve the problems that obstructed their paths. Here I place Gino Paolucci, who, when he saw a mining company was illegally dumping in his own backyard, fought hard to stop it in its tracks. Also of this genre was Saul Price, who worked hard to improve educational and employment opportunities in his home base of San Diego, California. The distinction I am making is a differentiation, not a judgment, for each set of leaders in their own way gave us a sense of what might have been and what still could be if business were rigorously framed as a process that was not only about making money and selling things, but about reducing damage and improving our social and natural world. 1. John Bogle, founder of the Vanguard Group. Surprising as it may seem to most people, Americans are the greatest owners of wealth, not the 1% of the super rich who own so much of the private wealth. What I'm referring to are such massive assets as the public lands, which together with adjacent offshore seabed territory constitute 1/3 of the United States, the public airwaves, trillions of dollars in pension and mutual funds, and least recognized, trillions of dollars in government research and development given away to build the major industries of our economy, including biotech, computer, internet, drug, aerospace, and nanotech companies, and many other enterprises. The problem is that people do not control what they own. Corporations do, either directly or through their dominating influence over such government agencies as the Federal Communications Commission and the Departments of Agriculture, Interior, Defense, and Commerce. No one has recognized this difference between ownership and control better than John C. Bogle, best known for founding the giant Vanguard Group, with over $7 trillion in assets, and pioneering low-cost, low-fee investing with mutual funds and stock market index funds. I wanted to invite Bogle to participate in an event at DAR Constitution Hall in D.C., devoted to Breaking Through Power, a Historic Civic Mobilization. So I put in a call to Mr. Bogle to invite him to be our keynote speaker on September 27, 2016, about fiduciary duties as if shareholders mattered. His tone was friendly, but weary. He was in great demand by people hungry for the truth at various levels about corporate greed, the ripping off of investors, especially individuals, and the excessive power of the Wall Street crowd. Jack, as he insisted on being called, was a big thinker and a relentless doer, a man whose integrity and steadiness contrasted with fast-talking speculators with fully monetized minds. Years earlier, admiring investors calling themselves Bogleheads combined to form clubs around the country. Everyone wanted a piece of Jack, and now, in his late 80s, I was asking for half a day of his time. He sighed and said that he might be able to shift a meeting that day and come down from Pennsylvania. He did, and spoke before a rapt audience. In 1951, he wrote his Princeton undergraduate thesis on this newfangled thing called a mutual fund. He was prophetic. And, like most innovators, he was ahead of his time and therefore mocked or dismissed. Those were the days of high fixed commissions and few required disclosures about companies' financial conditions. The brokerage industry was a uniform, smug fortress against change and diverse offerings for investors. It's hard to imagine what Jack Bogle had to endure and overcome as he threw himself into a life and career with an almost missionary zeal. He wrote 10 books, ran a fast-evolving business, crossed swords with the state and already established investment industry that often spread disinformation about him, raised 6 children with his wife, and educated himself in the classics, history, and poetry, all while maintaining a sense of humor. He possessed a level of generosity and understanding of people and places that amazed his friends. He suffered his first heart attack in 1960 when he was 30, and other heart attacks followed until he received a heart transplant at age 66 in 1996. When he was 37 years old, his doctor urged him to retire, given his perilous condition. Jack simply thanked him and found another physician. Aaron Arvidland and Art Carey of the Philadelphia Inquirer said after his passing at age 89 in January 2019 that he displayed the energy of men half his age, and his pace and ambition were the more remarkable because of his lifelong battle with heart disease, the result of a congenital defect that affected the heart's electrical current. He just had to believe that he loved what he was doing so much that mortal risk was never high on his radar screen. He resumed playing squash and tennis after his transplant, a testimony to psychosomatic triumph, perhaps. On his passing, Vanguard Chief Executive Officer Tim Buckley said that Jack Bogle made an impact not only on the entire investment industry, but more importantly, on the lives of countless individuals saving for their futures or their children's futures. He democratized and simplified investing and made it affordable for the average American. He was the original industry disruptor, said Peter G. Fitzgerald, a former Republican U.S. Senator from Illinois. Author and investment manager William Bernstein said, Jack could have been a multi-billionaire on par with Gates and Buffett. Instead, he turned his company into one owned by its mutual funds, and in turn their investors, to provide its customers the lowest price. He basically chose to forgo an enormous fortune to do something right for millions of people. I don't know any other story like it in American business history. At his death, Bogle's fortune was estimated to be $80 million, while his counterparts at higher fee fidelity are worth billions. Rick Stengel, former managing editor of Time, worked with Bogle, who then was the chair of the National Constitution Center's board, and saw a different side of the man. He was like the last honorable man. a complete straight shooter. Jack, he said, used the phrase so-and-so has all had and no cattle to describe a gas bag. Stengel said, Jack was all cattle and not very much had. Mel Lindauer, a Boglehead leader and co-author of The Boglehead's Guide to Investing, had this to say. What impressed me most about Jack was his humility and approachability. His zeal for his mission of helping investors get a fair shake was legendary. He worked tirelessly toward that goal, and his message never changed with the investing climate. The world won't be the same without Jack. He was a true American hero. Was that over the top about the world not being the same again? If you define the world as the investing world in the United States, no one today has the credibility that Jack had, or indeed the record, the knowledge, the just-right admonishing tone, a complete sense of the specialized hypocrisy of his occupational peers for rank speculation, reckless assumption of debt, obscene multimillion-dollar paychecks, and golden parachutes. Who else among that crowd then concluded that they had violated their duty as fiduciaries, as stewards, in favor of their self-enriching sales pitches? Who else would challenge the abuses of others in his field? He wanted capitalism, finance, and fund management to return to the standards involved in one of his favorite words, stewardship. Arthur Zeigel, former chairman of Merrill Lynch Investment Management, who was a Bogle friend for many years, said, He held our industry to a higher standard than it held itself, and I think a lot of people took umbrage at that. Paul Miller, a longtime friend and an investment manager himself, noted that he never failed to mention in speech after speech and talk after talk that money managers had failed miserably to earn their high fees, calling them croupiers at the gambling table. Going to Bogle's bedrock personality qualities, William Bernstein declared, He cared enough about his clients to personally answer their letters. He cared enough about his employees to be on a first-name basis with thousands of them and to pitch in at the phone banks when things got busy. And in the end, he cared enough about his country that he spent much of his last two decades away from home, tirelessly crusading against an increasingly elephantine and dysfunctional financial system. At age 76, Bogle reflected what Bernstein said when he wrote his fifth book, The Battle for the Soul of Capitalism. He was not a revolutionary. He was instead, as he put it, in a lover's quarrel with a capitalism run amok on the backs of defenseless savers and investors. Though he served on advisory committees of the Securities and Exchange Commission, SEC, he was under no illusions about that captured agency, nor the chances of ever becoming nominated to become SEC chairman. The furthest he reached and achieved was the mutual principle, namely that Vanguard was not to be a company owned by shareholders on the stock exchanges, like BlackRock. It became a structure owned by the investors in its funds, not by shareholders in a publicly traded company or a small group of institutional investors. That allowed Vanguard to run cheaply and efficiently, with minimum costs to the investors who bought many of its more than 400 mutual and index funds. No diversions and stratifications with stock price watching, options, executive compensations based on stock prices, stock buyouts, and all the rest of the plutocratic baggage ultimately and directly charged to the investors. Mutual Vanguard did not mean a fully open democratic structure. It was still top-down, and the investors had little engagement in the governance of Vanguard. What Mutual did, however, was put important restraints on executive greed, executive manipulation, and executive conflicts of interest against their owners. As we shall see, Jack Bogle was far more than a one-note Charlie, gigantic as that one note turned out to be. He cared about the injustices in the entire economy and the pathway for an obsessed commercial culture. At a gathering in Philadelphia with Governor Ed Rendell and President Bill Clinton, he observed of our economy, almost plaintively, that the disparity in income is deeply regrettable. I don't know what we do about it exactly. When I heard Jack say this, I thought he must have known. He knew what Western Europe had known for decades, that a higher minimum wage, full health insurance, fairer tax systems, freer public services such as public transit and tuition-free college education, as was done for students after World War II from the City University of New York to the University of California, are ways to ameliorate income inequality. Jack knew all these programs, but not the practical ways to achieve them through the one powerful institution that could deliver them, the U.S. Congress, populated officially by 535 people who need votes more than campaign cash. This gap affected other people written about in this volume. A simple explanation is that they didn't know how to get such proposals through Congress, mostly, I believe, because it was outside their expertise, too embroiling and especially draining on their time and the necessity to concentrate on their businesses. With Jack, it wasn't fear of controversy. It was the disruption of his concentration on what he chose as his life's work. Another way of putting it is that his plate was full, with a creative routine that would have to confront an entirely new experience and master an array of talents not suited to his studied skills. As with an athlete whose muscles and reactions and temperaments are suited to his or her chosen sport, making it in another sport, even if he or she wants to do so, is a challenge. See Michael Jordan. What Jack did discover that was perfectly congenial to his talents and his self-described combativeness was the relentless and incremental displacement of his rival high-fee, poorer-surface competition. Hence, Vanguard's low expenses benefited mutual fund investors and introduced them to the better performance index funds that he innovated. The arithmetic was decisive. But the routine that investors had to change was an uphill struggle. Just like switching banks, switching from one's investment advisors or conventional mutual funds requires overcoming apathy and procrastination and the bureaucratic hurdles erected by one's existing financial institutions. He went all over the country extolling Vanguard's better deal. He wrote everywhere, including best-selling books, about low-expense index fund investing that spread the risk beyond specialized mutual funds. Suffice to say, Vanguard spotted the giant Fidelity mutual funds, slowly caught up to them, and then, accelerating, raced past them, just the way Walmart surpassed Sears Roebuck. Bogle was nothing if not persistent. Year after year, his low fees and index funds approach gained ground, prompting the Nobel Prize laureate, economist Paul A. Samuelson, to write, "John Bogle has changed a basic industry in the optimal direction. Of very few, this can be said." His strategy is best called a displacement movement with three prongs, starting in 1975. First was his mutual form of governance by Vanguard fund investors. This eliminated daily conflicts of interests and allegiances by management toward what would have been outside shareholders. The investors in the various Vanguard mutual funds owned them. Second, he created stock indexing, meaning that, for safety, people could put their money in the famous Vanguard 500 index fund that consisted of 500 companies that is about as diversified as the overall market. Third, he cut fees, and in the process, educated investors on how very much they were losing in much higher exactions imposed and compounded over time by competitors like the giant Fidelity group of funds based in Boston. As the New York Times reported, Vanguard's asset-weighted average fee has fallen in the past 20 years to 0.10% from 0.25%, according to Morningstar Inc., while many traditional funds will demand 1% or more. The large savings from such low-cost index funds were kept by the investors. Over time, Jack has proven that indexing produced better results overall than most actively managed mutual funds picking stocks. There were none of the perverse incentives that often came with traditional investment management companies. That is why the super investor and financier, Warren Buffett, told the Wall Street Journal in 2009 that if all investors heeded his, Bogle's, ideas, they would be hundreds of billions of dollars better off than they are now. Buffett's Berkshire Hathaway, with so many subsidiaries, is a kind of diversified modified index fund and, some may say, has proven Buffett's point, even without paying a dividend. Bogle wasn't always of this opinion. Writing in the Financial Analyst's Journal in 1960 under a pen name, he rejected what later became index fund investing. Doubling down 13 years later, he said that neither compensation of salesmen nor profitability of broker-dealers and underwriters is excessive. Being fired in 1974 from his top post at the Wellington Fund, must have concentrated his attention on the fundamental questions of his premises and calculations and led to a dramatic revision of his thinking. By 1977, Vanguard eliminated sales commissions and middlemen and went no load. With a mutual ownership structure, that is, owned by its investors or customers, he avoided the demands of shareholders for ever greater profits based on high fees, commissions, and churning. The next decade, however, was hard going, as Bogle was ridiculed by his much larger competitors like Fidelity, whose president scoffed at being satisfied with average returns. "The name of the game is to be the best," he declared. One could almost hear the sneer in his voice. But like the race between the hare and the tortoise, more and more investors began to wonder what they were getting for these very high fees, paying for essentially very little, and began to turn to Vanguard's assortment of mutual funds with dramatically lower fees yet excellent service. Then in 2018, Jack did it again. He warned that if the success of the giant index funds continued, Vanguard, BlackRock, and State Street Global comprised 17% of the total U.S. stock market value, it could lead to the three giants dominating the market. By 2030, the big three might own 30% or more of the U.S. stock market, effective control. He then concluded, as only one Jack Bogle could dare to admit, that his booming progeny would lead to such concentration as not to serve the national interest. Have you ever heard the heads of the military weapons industry saying that too many weapons of mass destruction bought by the Pentagon would not serve the national interest? Or the heads of the drug industry saying that they're selling too many drugs and not serving the people's health? Or the giant oil, gas, and coal industry saying that they are producing and burning too much tonnage from their wells and mines? As was his wont, Bogle went from warning to possible remedies. He urged, one, more timely public disclosure by index funds of their voting policies, two, public documentation of each engagement with corporate managers, and most importantly, three, legislation making crystal clear the fiduciary duty to the interests of the investors. I always had one concern about Bogle's blanket statement that index funds provide investors with the most effective stock market strategy of all time. Buy American business and hold it forever, and do so at rock-bottom cost. But what if you need to cash out for living expenses, or for a one-time huge medical expense, or a home down payment? What if that need arose in 2008 to 2009, when index funds crashed along with the stock markets? When do you sell, sensing a rampage of speculative risk? You must have some strategy of timing, of when to get out when the signs of a collapse are evident. Or you can only invest your savings for a few years, and when you want to take advantage of a hot sector, such as technology stocks. Not all investors can behave as worker pension funds who have longer time horizons. When confronted with the reversal of Obama's fiduciary rule, scuttled by President Trump, Bogle once again optimistically said that investor demands and index fund expansion are starting to force brokerage firms to practice clients-first fiduciary principles, regardless of any mandatory rule by the government. Again and again, Bogle pointed out how his innovations were forcing the industry to do voluntarily what the SEC has been blocked from requiring. In 2011, the SEC allowed shareholders to propose to management that they, the shareholders, decide policies on the company's political spending, campaign contributions. Bogle saw this opening as a way to blunt the Supreme Court's opening the door wide for companies to make the unlimited independent political contributions for or against candidates for public office. He thought that shareholders, not self-interested corporate managers, executives, should and can decide policies on corporate political contributions. He wanted shareholders to insist on a resolution that the corporation shall make no political contributions without the approval of the holders of at least 75% of its shares outstanding. No major corporation has done this. He felt it urgent to do something to slow down the cash that is subverting our political system. Certainly, he declared, the institutional shareholders have the power to make this and other reforms, such as runaway executive compensation, happen. But with a handful of exceptions, the participation of our institutional money managers, including Vanguard, I might add, has been limited, reluctant, and unenthusiastic. Perhaps they feared angering the large corporate clients whose pension and thrift funds they manage, that is, the very corporations whose shares fill their investment portfolios. It is an obvious conflict of interest, however often denied. That is not all. He decried that most of the large mutual and pension funds are themselves owned or controlled by giant global financial conglomerates, such as the big banks and insurance companies. Shares of these giants are held by the institutional investors, resulting in a web that won't be easily untangled. Still, Jack, who had a cheerful, optimistic disposition, held out hope that these big mutual and pension funds and university endowments would observe their fiduciary duty and put the interest of the small investors in pension funds that are their clients before their own. He wanted them to bring democracy to corporate governance, recognize conflicts that arise from the interlocking interests of our corporate and financial systems, and take that first step along the road to reducing the dominant role that big money plays in our political system. A fine exhortation, but how is this to be done? Organizing individual shareholders has been tried over the past 50 years and failed. It has been like the proverbial herding of cats. Trying to organize large institutional shareholders like the Big Three has been met with no response or rhetorical concurrence about the proposed goals, but with no action. We had this experience when we sent letters to 100 large money managers, mutual funds, pension funds, and university endowments, asking them to oppose out-of-control executive compensation of major corporations. Executives' pay has risen to more than 350 times the average worker's wages from about 28 in 1980. Sent twice, the letter was ignored by most of the funds. Those who answered did so with routine acknowledgments. About half a dozen, including BlackRock, invited us to meet with or contact them to discuss the matters further. This was done. We're still awaiting any follow-through. But people like Jack Bogle are obviously more serious. Around 2014, I sent him a proposal which I called the Penny Brigade. It had occurred to me that a tiny fraction of 1% of the literally trillions of shares of the top 500 corporations could be self-assessed by their owners, say a penny a share a year, to provide enough funds to hire 500 experienced full-time watchdogs over the 500 companies. Consider the arithmetic. Cisco alone has about 5 billion shares outstanding. If owners of a mere 10 billion shares from the trillions of shares of S&P 500 companies contributed a penny a share, there would be $100 million a year to retain a team of watchdogs coordinating with one another for the kinds of reforms on behalf of investors that Bogle, Bob Monks, Steve Silberstein, Steve Clifford, and a few other stalwart watchdogs of the financial world have been urging for decades. Imagine if the penny assessment covered 20 billion shares. A powerful investor protection law firm could be established working on the SEC, Congress, and the opposing corporate lobbies. Mr. Bogle and others receiving this proposal wrote back favorably about the idea, but did not offer to either raise funds or participate in its furtherance. It is lying fallow, notwithstanding that my initial foray with the Penny Brigade focusing on Cisco resulted in enough media coverage and penny pledges to persuade Cisco to announce the company's first dividend, 2.9%, in its history, and to unload a little of the $45 billion in retained earnings assumed to be the management's piggy bank instead of the owner's shareholders' money. Over these years, particularly in the mid-1990s, Jack Bogle started to wonder how the mad rush for profits and executive pay at any price would impact not just the morale of corporate workers, but also the general citizenry. Violating customary mores, muscling Washington to further loosen long-established regulatory restraints, such as those on stock buybacks, and weakening the Great Depression's reforms, could lead to a rampant speculation with other people's money and have disastrous ramifications for the economy and in the public square. He could see better than most observers the multiple tiers of conflicts of interest by management against investors, and even internally against one another. Neither boom nor bust provided any speed bumps. During the Silicon Valley boom and stock market bust, nothing changed. Earlier, the collapse of the savings and loan industry and the successful prosecution of over 800 culpable executives did not lead to any collective sobering pauses in the mad rush for super wealth by the few. Get it while you can, seems to be the operative motto. The much larger collapse of the giant banks, brokerage firms, and some insurance behemoths during the 2007 to 2008 Wall Street collapse, the loss of 8 million jobs, the stripping of trillions of dollars in mutual and pension funds, and the massive resultant taxpayer bailout, produced only minor embarrassment for the reckless financiers. But by 2011, it was off to the races again. Bogle was taking all this in while his fast-growing Vanguard, from which he had retired in 2000, was continuing without significant losses and no overt scandals, unlike its hyper-commercialized counterparts. In fact, Vanguard was entering its fastest growth period ever. Drawing on his lifetime of reading economics, philosophy, history, and poetry, he began to write a book, published in 2009 with the title, intriguing for a financier, of Enough: True Measures of Money, Business, and Life. Unlike most books of rumination by well-known people in the business world, this was far more than tales of success and other life engagements. Bogle was talking to his wide-ranging world of business people and drawing them out of their cocoons, first as moneymakers, and then as human beings with families and their possible civic lives connected to the future of their country. The book took people like Arthur Levitt, former chairman of the Securities and Exchange Commission, further than Levitt's own addresses to investors about the world beyond obsession with bottom-line behavior. He called Enough must reading for millions of U.S. investors disenchanted by today's culture of greed, accounting distortions, corporate malfeasance, and oversight failure. Bogle made sure every Vanguard employee received a copy. The Princetonian was really a good and clear writer. Maybe it was the air of the Adirondacks, where he spent his summers, that cleared his mind for contemplating reality over myth, for fundamental values over expedient rationalizations. His chapter titles are a master list of concise aphorisms that could be the outline of an indelible course in the nation's business schools, assuming they are capable of entertaining such reflections. These chapter headings explain what I mean. 1. Too much cost, not enough value. 2. Too much speculation, not enough investment. 3. Too much complexity, not enough simplicity. 4. Too much counting, not enough trust. 5. Too much business conduct, not enough professional conduct. 6. Too much salesmanship, not enough stewardship. 7. Too much management, not enough leadership. 8. Too much focus on things, not enough focus on commitment. 9. Too many 21st century values, not enough 18th century values. 10. Too much success, not enough character. Then, in the final section called Wrapping Up, What's Enough, he gives the Bogle treatment to what's enough for me, for you, for America. From even just what you know so far about this man from Malvern, Pennsylvania, wouldn't this trail of contemplation be a great webinar with thousands of people participating at a time? I'd like very much to be a moderator of such a dynamic extension of Jack Bogle into the future. This would be a good starting point in creating a legacy for Vanguard's founder. These provocative chapter headings, in their totality, represent Jack's professional and overall philosophy of life. His insights demonstrate that what is past is prologue. The first paragraph, in his introduction, told the story of how he got the title of his now classic little volume of experience and wisdom. In his words, at a party given by a billionaire on Shelter Island, Kurt Vonnegut informs his pal Joseph Heller that their host, a hedge fund manager, had made more money in a single day than Heller had earned from his wildly popular novel, Catch-22, over its whole history. Heller responds, yes, but I have something that he will never have. Enough. Note where Bogle takes that word, enough. Joseph Heller captured in that powerful single word, enough, not only our worship of wealth and the growing corruption of our professional ethics, but ultimately the subversion of our character and values. Bogle decried chasing the false rabbit of success, too often bowing down at the altar of the transitory and finally meaningless, and failing to cherish what is beyond calculations, indeed eternal. In his opening chapter, Too Much Cost, Not Enough Value, Bogle points to a truth not often noted in Economics 101. He begins with a 19th century English epigram. Some men rest a living from nature and with their hands. This is called work. Some men rest a living from those who rest a living, from those who rest a living from nature and with their hands. This is called finance. Apart from leaving out half the human race, which at that time produced great value at little cost to the men, this epigram meant that finance was a derivative business that was abstractly reliant on real production and exchanges of that production. Finance used to be a small part of the economy, but in recent decades it has grown to be the single largest part of the U.S. economy, making up about a third of all the profits of all the sectors of the economy, such as manufacturing, healthcare, technology, and energy. To Jack, there is a lot of snare and delusion enveloping investors who think they make more than they do because they do not subtract the annual costs deducted in a compounded way over the years from their packages. The 20% plus 2% of the hedge fund's gains, leaving you absorbing all the losses. It is the drip-drip of brokerage commissions, management fees, sales loads, advisory fees, the costs of all that advertising, lawyers' fees, and so on. Vanguard shows the impact of such costs. Imagine you have $100,000 invested. If the account earned 6% a year for the next 25 years and had no costs or fees, you'd end up with about $430,000. If, on the other hand, you paid 2% a year in costs, after 25 years, you'd only have about $260,000. That's right. The 2% you paid every year would wipe out almost 40% of your final account value. 2% doesn't sound so small anymore, does it? Clearly, he writes, the wonderful magic of compounding returns has been overwhelmed by the powerful tyranny of compounding costs. On balance, he concludes, our financial system subtracts value from our society. In the aggregate, he warns that continuation of such a costly system will undermine the ability of our citizens to accumulate savings for retirement. Bogle's analysis of reckless speculation could apply equally to gambling at the craps tables in Las Vegas. Sure, some people come up winners every day, but overall, in the aggregate, the gamblers lose to the house. Back to the epigram, he warns that until efficiency for the investor is the rule, the financial economy will continue to subtract inordinately from the value created by our productive businesses. Which brings us to the next lesson. Following distinguished jeremiahs such as the British economist John Maynard Keynes of too much speculation, not enough investment. About 90 years ago, Keynes described enterprise, investment, as forecasting the prospective yield of an asset over their whole life. Speculation, he said, was the activity of forecasting the psychology of the market. What Supreme Court Justice Potter Stewart said about pornography, I know it when I see it, also applies to speculation. First, the less than real assets of the economy are exchanged between buyer and seller. That is, the tangible goods and services that make up people's livelihoods, like land, motor vehicles, textiles, food, energy, housing, healthcare, etc. And the more the exchange is that of intangibles, the more likely we are to expect speculation. For example, stocks and bonds are once removed from the real economy, options and puts further removed as the bets that they are, and even further removed are exchanges of complex derivatives. The latter, based on algorithms, are bets on bets on bets on bets, and so on. Rank speculation. As one might guess, speculative activity in the stock market is usually much more short-term than investments. So rife with speculation are the stock markets that Bogle declared that the stock market is a giant distraction from the business of investing. Although speculation is quantitatively rampant in dollars and players, Bogle shows the arguments lead to the obvious conclusion.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.